Subscribe to our YouTube channel and press the bell icon to get the latest updates.
So how bad is the news on coronavirus spread in India at this moment? I'm starting with how bad, because obviously any spread can't be good news, and numbers are going up, so it's not good news. But how bad is it? So I will start this by reminding you of something that Goswami Tulsidas wrote in Ramayana, Jaki Rahi Bhavna Jaisi, Prabhu Murat Dekhi Tin Taisi. That means, as you perceive of God, that is the image in which God appears in front of you. Bad translation, but I hope you get the drift. So you can translate it into something else. It can be Jaisi Drishti Vaisi Srishti, or you can say glass is half full or half empty. So you can use the same data set to arrive at different conclusions. The data set we have today is the latest ICMR study on the spread of coronavirus in the country. Now, this study is different, and this data is different from everything we've been seeing so far. What we've been seeing so far is testing data of those who were suspects, who were symptomatic, who had traveled from overseas, or who had been in contact with those who had traveled from overseas and had been found to be carrying coronavirus. So these were suspected people. They were tested. There India's, I don't want to say success rate, there India's, I hate to even say positivity rate, I would say that about 3% tested positive for the virus, which is quite low by international standards. This was not seen to be satisfactory, also because India was testing too few people. So ICMR, which is the nodal scientific authority for leading this effort in India, they started a sentinel surveillance program at 50 plus of India's major hospitals, where they were picking up a sample, a representative sample of all cases of SARI, S-A-R-I, severe acute respiratory infection, like pneumonia. And these were all ICU cases. So these were seriously sick cases who were in ICU. So they were picking up that sampling data, not every patient, but that sampling data from limited hospitals, not all hospitals. That's why it was called a sentinel surveillance survey. That carried on till 19th of March. So from 15th February till 19th of March was the sentinel surveillance. In that surveillance, 965 samples were lifted, of which only 2 tested positive for coronavirus. 2 out of 965. But by this time, the country's overall numbers were rising. Also, India did not quite have the ability to test a much larger number of people. We are a large country, not that rich, and test kits are in short supply globally. Also, the antibody test kits are still in the process of clearance. In fact, even globally, in most countries, they are still in the process of clearance, including in the US. So this was then extended from just being a sentinel surveillance. They started testing all the SARI cases in India's hospitals. Now, they were all tested. So then between 19th of March and 2nd of April, that is 13 more days, 4,946 more cases were tested. These were all people in ICUs, really sick with some kind of pneumonia and in real distress. Of these 4,946, almost 5,000 cases, 102 turned out positive. So if you add it all up, then a total of about 6,000 cases have now given us 104 positive for coronavirus. Now, of these cases, a bunch of them, that is about 40, don't have a history of either foreign travel or an obvious immediate history of contact with somebody with a history of foreign travel. Now, is this an indication, or is this the final evidence that community transmission in India has broken out? There are many people, including in the media, who would like to believe yet that yes, this is now, here we go, this is a smoking gun, community transmission has broken out. Community transmission is defined as a kind of transmission where a person comes with the infection and he says, where could have I got it from? I went to the market, I went to my school, I went to my office. I have no idea. I don't remember meeting anybody who might have had this problem or who might have come from overseas. So when that spreads on a large basis, when you can't trace contacts, then it's called community transmission, but it has to happen on a certain scale. So if you want to say that, oh, but the scale is available, then you can say, as you will find many in the media saying, and many others would say also, and many researchers would also say, that 38% of those who've tested positive do not have a contact or foreign travel history. So 38% is very strong evidence that community transmission has broken out. Now, let's look at it the other way. I told you, glass half, half full, jaisi drishti, vaisi srishti, jaki rahi bhavna jaisi, prabhu murat, dekhi tin taisi. So, if you want to look at it differently, which is the way I would prefer to look at it, because I am an optimist in this situation, I'd rather be an optimist, while being highly suspicious of all data and giving it very heavy fact check. If 104 out of 6,000 have tested positive, that's about 1.8% of a very sick sample, of a sample of very sick people, with all the gravest symptoms of the disease that is also caused by coronavirus. 1.8%. I don't want to say only 1.8%, because anybody being sick with this virus at that level to require ICU treatment is quite sick. So 104 or 1.8% of your total sample. Of that 1.8%, 38% do not have a history of foreign travel or contacts as yet. If you take a percentage of the base, now either you can say 38% of all those who have turned out positive don't have a contact history or foreign travel history, or you can say that 0.6% of 6,000 are sick with corona and don't have a contact or foreign travel history. So there is a big difference between 0.6% of your larger, of your full sample of 6,000 and 38% of 104 or 38% of 1.8% of the 6,000. So that's how you look at it. Government of India spokesperson today, Lav Agarwal, said no, community transmission has not broken out. If it does, we will tell you, because it's in our interest to tell you, because we then want greater caution. But the fact is that the argument that, look, these are 40 people who are very sick right now, we may not have been able to track all their contacts. Now, community transmission is very different from social transmission. Somebody can come from overseas, can be driven from airport to Pune. One case took place like that. One couple came in from overseas. They were corona positive. They were driven to Pune by a hired cab. In 2 days, the cab driver also came up with symptoms. Now, maybe that cab driver took another passenger somewhere. That passenger could have come up with symptoms. That passenger could have gone with somebody. So this is now a chain of contacts. So once again, it's quite possible that there is some community transmission or there is some limited community transmission. But it's also quite possible that these are still untraced contacts. Because for community transmission to break out, that means the virus is sitting on surfaces around us. That means a situation like Italy, Spain, France, etc., etc. There is no evidence right now of that happening. Now, once again, testing. India is testing too little. In fact, if you look around the world, in fact, there is a website I look at every night before I go to sleep. It's called worldometers.info, which maintains the best database on many things, but also on coronavirus. So every evening before going to sleep, which is very late, I check and see how are the worst hit countries doing. So I'm happy to see that Italy is turning the corner, Spain is about to turn the corner, New York City is turning the corner in the sense that they are flattening the curve. In Italy, for the first time yesterday, net admissions in ICU came down for the first time since the outbreak began. But there, when I look, I find another very interesting, fascinating data point. That is, of the samples India is testing, the number of positive cases, the percentage of positive cases, is the lowest for any major country. So while you can say that India is testing too little, it's also true that India is only testing cases which are highly suspicious or where there is a strong reason to believe or suspect that there is a problem. But even there, in that limited sample, India's, I don't want to say success rate, India's rate of finding corona positive patients is just about 3%. Many European countries go up to 30%, 40%. So this is a big difference. And this is something we should not just discount good news because it looks too good to be true. And we should not be so superstitious as to say that if this is good news, let me not talk about it because it may turn the other way. On the other hand, we tend to paint the devil on the wall. And in the past, I have explained to you why that's not such a good idea. So only 3% in India are turning out positive in these highly suspicious or suspect cases. The data now from private labs. Just a few days back, private labs were allowed to test until the Supreme Court came in. And remember that famous line, or infamous line, the road to hell is paved with good intentions. So with good intentions, they said private labs will now test people for free. And that process, unfortunately, has stopped for now. We'll see when it resumes. But until now, private labs have tested 16,000 samples. That's a lot of samples in quick time. Of those 16,000 samples, and any time a private lab checks, they have to enter it on a government, on the government website. To not do so is illegal. I know I have many friends who run private labs who get a lot of pressure from their VIP clients saying, "Bhai, test kar lo." Lekin sarkar ko batana nahi. Usko, if you tell them, they'll come and put a poster in front of my house. They'll quarantine me. My neighbors will stop talking with me. But they cannot hide it. It's a very serious crime. So they are not hiding. So of the 16,000 that have been tested, only 320 have tested positive. 320 out of 16,000. And these are outside the government system. Again, these are people who are coming to test, to get tested, because they have something to worry about. Or they might have either foreign travel history or a contact or symptoms, because they also have to be approved by a qualified doctor to be tested. The test is expensive. It's also uncomfortable. Nobody wants to just go and get swabs shoved into their noses or throats just like that. But even then, this rate is only 0.2%. Once again, 0.2%. That is 1/5 of 1%. That is 2 in 1,000. Just think about it. So if you combine all the data, news can go bad tomorrow. It's like saying, like we say in cricket commentators' curse, somebody says this batsman is batting beautifully and Mr. Rahul Dravid gets out at 99. Right? And they say this is commentator's curse, because the moment you said somebody is doing well, so-and-so gets out. But let's not go by superstition. Let's look at basic data. So I would say if you look at the basic data so far in India, the situation is so far so good. And as I watch global media at night, I find there's a lot of discussion right now on BBC, CNN, on French, Russian, Italian, Spanish media on why certain countries are not getting such a high rate of infection and mortality. Obviously, India is a prominent example there. I mean, Pakistan is a prominent example. Bangladesh, these are large populations. And today you cannot hide people if thousands of them are just dying like flies here and there. It's not possible today to hide any of that. And that is why this discussion over BCG, hydroxychloroquine, etc., is coming in. So this is the data. My view, editorial view, this is not the beginning of community transmission yet. The news is not too bad. If anything, lockdown has worked. If you take out the Tablighi cluster, India, once again, whatever the factor, It may be BCG, maybe because all of us have had chloroquine in our lives, or maybe it's the weather, temperature, whatever. In fact, I found on CNN one big expert in America saying, maybe these countries are not getting so many sick people because people in those countries don't travel overseas so much. Bit rich. Delhi airport is probably among the five biggest airports, busiest airports in the world. So people do travel. So there is something. Let's not discount what is not good news, but not such bad news. Having said so, I talked about this ICMR study, and you can see the entire study. I am giving you as a link the study and also my colleague Swagata Yadavar's story on the study. It's been published by Indian Journal of Medical Research, very prestigious. It has also very senior names, real dadas of this research, including Nivedita Gupta and Dr. Ganga Khedkar at ICMR. So check this study out. The second thing that's coming out is from a little district in Germany. It's called the district of Heinsburg on the border of Netherlands. Heinsburg is also called Germany's Wuhan. Now, why is it called Germany's Wuhan? Because that's where the disease first surfaced in Germany. That's where the first death took place in Germany. And that's where now a number of German virologists have gathered to make that a test case, like a laboratory of coronavirus. So they are studying it there. So there is IC reports, and I think you will have, I'll give you a link for one or two of those, including in The Guardian. There's a professor, Hendrik Streeck, from University Hospital Bonn, who's running a large team there. And they are now going from family to family to family to family and testing. A very large number of people are infected, particularly in a little village of Gangelt. And there they are coming up with very interesting findings. For example, they say from their findings, very important, that so far they have not seen any transmission of the virus in supermarkets, restaurants, hairdressers, and such places. Then they say that, look, whatever evidence we have is that virus has spread from close get-togethers of a lot of people. So Gangel, for example, it started when a couple came from outside with the infection, and they participated in the very crowded local carnival. And after that, a lot of people got infected. So they became super spreaders, and carnival, people were close together, lots of human beings, nobody knew what was happening, who was touching whom, who was sneezing, who was coughing. Even if you didn't want to be in the line of a cough, you had nowhere to go. So a carnival, not a very apt comparison, but a carnival and a congregation. Remember the Tablighi congregation? There is no difference, because once you put a lot of human beings together and even one of them is infected, then it's very difficult for others to escape. So that's a bigger threat than touching something and getting infected. In fact, these researchers reported that they swabbed in these households door handles, toilets, mobile phones, remote controls, everything. And in those swabs, they picked up the evidence of the virus. But they were not able to replicate that virus in the lab. So their understanding is that maybe what is left on these surfaces is the RNA of the virus, which shows up in tests, but virus is dead. Just the RNA is there. So this virus is not infectious or not replicable. Early days, but that is their study. They also went to houses which already had many infected people. And in those houses, from the surfaces, they were not able to pick up virus which was infectious, which means which could be replicated. Now, other virologists are talking about it in Germany. There is another virologist called Christian Drosten from Berlin, who says that, look, if you look at all this evidence, you can now say quite confidently that you cannot get this virus from coins, currency notes, and I presume newspapers, things like that. And based on this, Germany's Federal Institute of Risk Assessment, or BFR, has said that so far they have seen no evidence of contact transmission. And if at all it has to happen, somebody has to cough in his or her hand, touch a door handle, and then very soon afterwards, you have to open the same door handle and take your hand to your mouth and nose. So it has to be that quick. Now, in the US, National Institute of Health and others have found that the virus survives for longer. For example, 3 hours on plastic and steel, stainless steel, 24 hours on paper, and 3 hours in aerosols. But once again, the German researchers, including at Robert Koch Institute, are saying that these are tests conducted in experimental conditions. You can never be sure of these. So don't worry about this.